hopefully you guys can all hear me okay. And thanks for letting me to come along and talk about a project I've been really passionate about over the last few years. Just before we get started and jump in, I'd just like to acknowledge that I'm speaking to you from and all of the work that I'm talking about was undertaken on Gadabinud country in Cape Otway, and I'd like to acknowledge elders past and present. And also just acknowledge that although I'm talking today, this is a huge effort from quite a broad and diverse team, ranging from universities through to NGOs and even a genetics consultancy and land managers as well. So pretty much, one second, is this working? Here we go. So fox control in Australia is certainly nothing new. It's a fairly ubiquitous action that we take to try and limit the, negative impacts of these species on our fauna, on agricultural values. And whenever we undertake these programs, generally at the end of the day, we're going to end up in a situation where we intervene with some form of lethal control and we end up with less foxes in the landscape. So ideally, there's some monitoring that goes on when we undertake these programs. And traditionally, that's generally been restricted by sort of the ecology of these species to things like non-direct or indirect activity indexes. So things like sand track counts or, scat counts or spotlighting transects. And more recently, certainly we've been able to sort of incorporate remote sensing cameras into our sort of monitoring toolbox to figure out whether or not our programs are effective. However, and particularly when it comes to cameras, it's still very, very challenging to actually distinguish between different individuals. So if we end up with, say, four images of a fox, it's quite hard, with some sort of context at least, to determine whether or not that's one fox four times, four foxes one time each, or sort of any other combination between. So I guess some of the more advanced statistical techniques that we now have access to, things like spatial mark resight models, you'd have a really hard time, I think, justifying their use for a species that's visually indistinguishable most of the time anyway. But there are other options, and that's sort of what I'm here to talk to you about today. And one of these options is the use of non-invasive genetic sampling. So collecting some form of leftovers from the species, traditionally scat, but we could also use hair, and sort of utilizing the genetic information stored within these samples to ideally end up with a nice, beautiful capture mark recapture data set to work with. Back in 2017, we found ourselves in a pretty wonderful position wherein Parks Victoria were pretty keen to tackle foxes at a landscape scale. And so they invited us along with other research organisations to have a bit of a chat and help design both the control program itself as well as monitoring and research around the program to see if it's working at a landscape scale. And so this is the Otway Ark. And we thought it would be a great opportunity to trial out, I guess, some of these alternative approaches to supplement the monitoring that was already going on, but also see if there's any major advantages from the use of these sort of relatively underutilized approaches. So what we decided to do was to set up a before and after control impact experiment. And we wanted to take advantage of the fact that fox scat was pretty easily detectable in the landscape here. And so what we decided to do was set up two transects, one in an area that was to be baited as part of the Otway Ark program, and another area about 5 or 6 kilometres away as the crow flies that would remain unbaited throughout the entire time. And what we really wanted to do was sample the fox populations by collecting scat at a range of different times throughout the control program. So ideally, we wanted to get two samples before anything happened in both landscapes and then follow up as that program evolved. The program itself sort of started off their baiting as a relatively intensive baiting pulse. So they were checking and replacing baits weekly for about 6 weeks at the initiation of the program and then moving that on to monthly baiting afterwards, ideally getting that short, sharp knockdown early on and then winding back that control to ideally keep that fox density low in the sort of, medium to long term. When it comes to scat surveys, non-invasive genetics, and eventually spatially explicit capture recapture, there's a really quite a juggling act going on. So there's a couple of things we needed to take into account and sort of honour when it came to designing an experiment around this. One is that we really needed to make sure our scats were of a known age. So in this case, ideally 48 hours or less of age. After that, the genotyping success, our ability to actually extract useful genetic information from these samples starts to tank a little bit, and it gets a little bit more complicated. So we don't want to pick up old scats. So the very first survey that we do each time we get out there was to effectively etch a sketch these transects clean. And then we collected scats every 2 days after that, up to a period of 10 days. We really wanted to make sure that session length was long enough to detect any individuals that were potentially in the landscape. We didn't feel like just simply going out there after 2 days would sort of create a large enough window that we had a chance at detecting every individual that was there. In effect, you boil all this down, and what it means is that your daily steps and your walking and running distance goes through the roof while this field work is going on. And so every second day we're walking these transects looking for scats. The field work was pretty glorious, remarkably simple to pull off. There was a little bit of training with the volunteers to make sure that we can adequately detect scats on these transects. And then when it came time to really roll this out, we would have two observers walk from opposite ends of the transects looking for scats within about a meter and a half of sort of where they were walking. And so that gave us pretty good coverage across the track there. We'd roll that out right across the 16-kilometer transect. One thing I did quickly want to point out here, though, is that a lot can change in 16 kilometers. We did take advantage of this infrastructure that was already present. But as you can see, there's sort of quite a wide gradient in terms of the substrate of the tracks that we're walking on, ranging from gravel through to dirt mud, as well as the width of the tree line, which I think is important when you're talking about, these animals, say foxes, sort of preferentially using linear features and how they use them. So just wanted to acknowledge that these transects were not all uniform all the way through, and it's something worth keeping in mind. So we walked over 2,000 kilometres across these sections, these sessions all up, effectively from Cape Otway to Sydney and back. And we were able to collect 616 scats across six sessions. Just wanted to show off here that there did appear to be fairly good coverage. We were quite happy to see that with no really large obvious chunks of each of these transects, sort of depauperate of scats. We were able to detect them in most areas. We were able to send these scats off for genetic analysis via microsatellites. And to be honest, I don't understand the intricacies of how they turn that genetic material from the scat into this wonderful capture mark recapture data set that I get to work with. But I am sort of able to play with this data set after it comes back. And we were able to detect 50 individual foxes. Interestingly, we detected sort of a lot of individuals a few times and a few individuals a lot of times. So those capture rates were relatively skewed, and that may speak to that sort of difference in preferential use of roads and tracks in our landscape. So combining this data set with spatially explicit capture recapture to generate density estimates and a multimodal inferencing analysis paradigm, so using model selection, we weren't able to actually identify any substantive impact of baiting on fox density in the baited landscape. But what was really quite surprising, and this is sort of one of the core takeaways from the talk here, is that fox density in our landscape was remarkably low to begin with. So you're talking at about 0.24 foxes per square kilometre. And look, it's very wet, rugged country. This is the first fox density estimate that we're aware of produced for this type of country, and it was, yeah, just a lot lower than we were expecting. These animals were being detected on camera traps sort of set up at a larger scale for occupancy analysis. They certainly were being picked up at a lot of cameras, but when it came time to actually, turning that into a density estimate, it was a much lower number than we thought there were in that landscape. Because we collected scats, it gives us a great opportunity to compare directly a activity index based on scats with sort of a more direct estimate of density as well. And so we can see here up the top, we've got our activity index, and down the bottom, we've got our density estimate. I would like to acknowledge that particularly with the density estimates, the precision is certainly not where we wanted it to be and where we envisioned it might be at the start of this program. And that is, again, largely driven by that much lower density of foxes in the landscape prior to any sort of control whatsoever. But hopefully you can see that during that baited period, there certainly did appear to be quite a substantial reduction in the number of scats that were being detected. But you'd have a hard time sort of saying that this was sort of equally seen in the density estimates. Although I will acknowledge that the point estimate of the density did start to decline a little bit. Okay, so really good opportunity there to compare these indices, mainly because often we're relying on indirect activity indices. And in this case, if the scats was all we had to figure out whether or not our program was working, we might be overestimating how successful that program was. It's no surprise that the baiting program didn't appear to be working all that much, primarily because, as I'm sure it's not really a surprise to anyone, a whole bunch of different things can interact to determine whether or not our program is successful. The type of methodology we use, do we bait, do we aerial bait, do we ground bait, do we adopt the cane of pest ejectors, et cetera, can really influence how effective our program is, how many resources, how much effort we throw into it, the ecological context as well. And I think this is important for our landscape in particular. They were road-based bait networks, and that was primarily based on that road network, which was actually fairly fairly depauperate. So not a whole lot of tracks throughout this area that we're looking at, which by default limits the amount of bait density you can achieve. The scale at which you're undertaking control, and of course any non-target bait takes issues. So with these animals, making them not available to foxes. But really, hopefully it's just another reinforcement that evaluating the efficacy of these programs is crucial. It's just not enough to assume that they're working. So one of the other, I'll quickly finish this up by just acknowledging that although we're able to estimate density via the use of genetic samples, when you can identify individuals in this way, you get a whole lot of supplementary information that really helps you understand what's going on in your control program. In this case, we can follow individual survival. And so after the baiting program had ceased on our baited transect, just about half of the foxes that we detected were animals that have been detected either before baiting had started or being detected consistently right through that program. So there certainly seemed to be a big cohort of animals that simply were not either encountering or taking baits. We were also able to determine or get a little bit of a glimpse into some fairly large-scale short-term movements. This is one female that effectively covered the entirety of the transect in 10 days. And again, it's a 16-kilometre transect. We're also able to get a little bit of insight into the genetic and familial relationships going on between foxes in our area. Although we didn't pick up any foxes moving between control and treatment transects, which was great. We're able to see here that via the genetic analysis, we can see it's quite a mixed population, with the blue animals coming from the control area and the red animals coming from the treatment landscape. Because we went with scats as well, we're able to actually, with a very, very minor sort of further injection of funding, we're able to get them sent off for dietary analysis as well. And so we're able to describe what makes up the diet of foxes in the Otways, as well as their density. Interestingly, they were taking advantage of things like platypus and even a far more swamp antechinus were appearing in their diet than we actually expected as well. So a lot of very useful supplementary information coming from this dietary analysis. And just finally, we really did end up with more questions than answers after running this study. And there's a lot of opportunities for improvement. One is to just improve our ability to detect scats, and incorporating conservation dogs and detection dogs into scat collection just makes a lot of sense. And it's something that we're actively pursuing as an extension of this research, working with the guys down at Phillip Island Nature Parks and these lovely little pooches here to help us find more scats. And finally, this sort of information really, really pairs well with some of the more advanced tools that we currently have to sort of estimate and sort of design fox control programs. In particular, I'm referring to Foxnet, which you'll hear about if you go to Alan Robley's talk later on today, which allows us to really sort of use the information on what we found out about fox density to sort of either alter or improve our program in the future and ideally achieve a better outcome. Because at the end of the day, that is what this program in particular was about to, or was created to achieve. And so I'd like, I guess, to finish with an acknowledgement that all of this work on monitoring foxes and the fox density is only half of the equation. Even if we're incredibly successful at reducing fox density, and we can demonstrate that via non-invasive sampling, this has to be sort of, it has to be paired with a positive ecological outcome if that's the overall objective of your fox control program. And I think that pretty much wraps me up there, guys. So, yeah, I'd just like to thank you all for listening. And, again, thank all the project partners.
Thanks, Mark. That was really good. I particularly liked the one way of dealing with low densities and I guess imprecise density estimates was to look at survival. You know, that offers an alternative, and you know, when you think about it, that may be the better way to go. Look, there was one question from Tony Cathcart which you you started to address right at the end there, which was whether there was any data to suggest a response in native animals to the baiting. I mean, I guess ultimately that's what baiting's for. You know, you might change fox numbers, but does it influence native species? Like prey species? Are there any data on that?
So there's an overall monitoring program for the Otway Ark, which is occupancy modelling at a sort of much larger scale. That work is currently ongoing in terms of analysis, but at least in the short term, it certainly doesn't seem as if there's a very strong response in the native species sort of bouncing back from fox predation. At least in the central forest where we undertook this work, again, that very low initial fox density may call into question how much of an impact we might actually see from a fox reduction in that area, at least. To begin with, again, it was a very, very surprising find to see that, there just simply weren't that many foxes around, and that they were probably ranging a lot further than we initially expected.
But that's sort of an interesting result as well, you know. So it's certainly worthwhile.